When humans intake alcohol, alcohol absorbed into the blood and delivered to the liver, which is basically the only organ that can metabolize ethanol. Over 90% of ethanol is oxidized in the liver and other 10% is excreted through the lungs and the urine. So when hepatocytes uptake ethanol from the blood, initially alcohol dehydrogenase oxidizes ethanol to acetaldehyde. In this reaction, as a cofactor, it uses NAD, which takes two electrons from ethanol and delivers them to electron transport chain with subsequent energy production. Then the second enzyme, acetaldehyde dehydrogenase, which can be mitochondrial and cytosolic, oxidizes acetaldehyde to acetate. The fate of acetate is that acetate then is converted by acetyl-CoA synthase to acetyl-CoA that goes into the Krebs cycle and subsequently into electron transport chain that results in energy production. The major problem is that this pathway was not intended to metabolize huge amount of ethanol at once. You know, the mother nature didn't know how advanced drinking can become humans. So it turns out that alcohol dehydrogenase becomes saturated even at moderate ethanol concentrations. And at this point, alcohol elimination becomes a zero-order kinetic process. To explain this, with even moderate ethanol concentration, alcohol dehydrogenase becomes fully saturated. It reaches its limit and cannot go faster. So at this point, it removes alcohol at a constant rate, no matter how much ethanol in the liver. We can depict this as a graph, for example, its ethanol concentration in the blood, and it's the rate of ethanol elimination, or basically we can say it's the speed of alcohol dehydrogenase. Basically, it tells that the speed of alcohol dehydrogenase is constant, no matter how much alcohol in the blood. Or we can take the ethanol concentration and time, and again, this line tells us that the enzyme eliminates the same amount of ethanol from the blood per unit time. So the rate of alcohol dehydrogenase is constant, no matter how much alcohol in the blood. And acetaldehyde dehydrogenase is also very slow. So if someone drinks too much alcohol, massive amount of ethanol goes into the liver, where enzymes do not have enough speed to convert all of ethanol to acetate. So acetaldehyde and ethanol accumulate in the liver tissue, then they exit into the blood, and some portion of them can leak through the blood-brain barrier into the brain tissue. In the brain, alcohol dehydrogenase is inactive, but ethanol still can be metabolized by another two pathways. In peroxisomes, ethanol can be oxidized by a catalase system, and in microsomes, ethanol is oxidized by cytochrome P enzymes, so both of them result in production of acetaldehyde. And both ethanol and to a greater extent acetaldehyde cause severe damage to the brain tissue. For example, hangover symptoms as headache, vomiting are caused exactly by acetaldehyde. But brain tissue is not even the major site of injury because all the dirty work here is done by the liver. And ethanol metabolism cause alterations in liver tissue. Ethanol stimulates activity of alcohol dehydrogenase and acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. And because the activity of both alcohol dehydrogenase and acetaldehyde dehydrogenase require a huge amount of NAD, this causes increase in NADH and decrease in NAD level in liver tissue. And this ethanol-induced high NADH to NAD ratio stimulates conversion of pyruvate to lactate that results in lactic acidosis. To explain this, recall that skeletal muscles during their anaerobic work by anaerobic glycolysis produce lactate that is uptaken by the liver tissue. It's a well-known Cori cycle, and liver is a major consumer of lactate because it can convert lactate to pyruvate and thereby use it in gluconeogenesis. But this conversion between pyruvate and lactate can occur in both directions, and the factor that determines in which direction it will go is the ratio of NADH to NAD. Because conversion of lactate to pyruvate requires NAD, and conversion of pyruvate to lactate NADH. The higher the NAD concentration, the higher will be amount of pyruvate, and the lower will be amount of lactate, and vice versa. The higher the NADH concentration, the higher will be amount of lactate, and the lower will be amount of pyruvate. So with alcohol consumption, increasing NADH to NAD ratio shifts this reaction towards lactate production, thereby also it decreases pyruvate concentration, which is the substrate of glucose production, so it decreases gluconeogenesis. In addition to this, high NADH to NAD ratio causes decrease in oxaloacetate, thereby inhibiting gluconeogenesis. The concept here is that in the cytosol, oxaloacetate is reduced by cytosolic malate dehydrogenase that use NADH to malate, and in the mitochondria malate is oxidized by mitochondrial malate dehydrogenase that use NAD to oxaloacetate, basically as a part of malate aspartate shuttle. And important that oxaloacetate is an intermediate metabolite of the Krebs cycle, but also is a substrate for glucose production that by conversion to phosphoenol pyruvate can be directly used in gluconeogenesis. And if NAD decreases, this causes decrease in formation of oxaloacetate, thereby it causes decrease in another gluconeogenic substrate, as a result it causes decrease in gluconeogenesis. Also, high NADH to NAD ratio causes increase in glycerol 3-phosphate. The concept here is that the reaction between dihydroxyacetone phosphate and glycerol 3-phosphate is catalyzed by glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase and occurs in both directions. And the factors that determine in which direction it will go is the ratio of NADH to NAD. If NAD prevails, then dehydroxyacetone phosphate is formed that can be used in gluconeogenesis. And if NADH prevails, then glycerol 3-phosphate is formed that can be used in triacylglycerol synthesis. So, in case of alcohol consumption, high NADH concentration stimulate formation of glycerol 3-phosphate and decrease the amount of dehydroxyacetone phosphate, thereby it depletes another gluconeogenic substrate. Together, this inhibition of gluconeogenesis causes severe fasting hypoglycemia. Also, high NADH to NAD ratio inhibits Krebs cycle. The concept here is that because metabolism of ethanol by alcohol dehydrogenase and aldehyde dehydrogenase consumes massive amount of NAD, it depletes cellular NAD stores, thereby it inhibits all pathways that have enzymes that use NAD as cofactor. And Krebs cycle has three enzymes that use exclusively NAD. It's isocitrate dehydrogenase, alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, which is also time-independent, and recall that chronic alcohol consumption can cause severe thiamine deficiency as it causes dysfunction of alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase that potentially can result in Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. So thiamine deficiency inhibits the activity of this enzyme even further, and the third enzyme is malate dehydrogenase. So, decreasing cofactor of these three enzymes causes inhibition of the entire Krebs cycle. Inhibition of Krebs cycle causes accumulation of acetyl-CoA in the mitochondrial matrix, and mitochondria use acetyl-CoA by two pathways. First of all, to correct hypoglycemic state, mitochondria from acetyl-CoA produce ketone bodies that exit into the blood and cause ketoacidosis. And also, massive amount of acetyl-CoA must be utilized, and there is no better storage material as triacylglycerols. Recall that triacylglycerols are totally hydrophobic, because of that they do not attract water, and this makes them extremely compact substances. So mitochondria transport acetyl-CoA into the cytosol, where acetyl-CoA is used in fatty acid synthesis. This results in increase in amount of fatty acids, and then from massive amount of fatty acids and glycerol, triacylglycerols are formed that cause hepatosteatosis. So, ethanol metabolism causes four major manifestations. It's lactic acidosis, fasting hypoglycemia, ketoacidosis, and hepatosteatosis. Also, there are some high-yield concepts to know. So, first of all, in some individuals, mitochondrial acetaldehyde dehydrogenase can be deficient. This makes oxidation of acetaldehyde even slower, so in this case, even intake of small amount of alcohol can induce massive accumulation of acetaldehyde that will cause significant brain damage, so this peculiar feature makes them alcohol intolerant. Also, we have two drugs that target enzymes of alcohol metabolism. The first one is Fomepizole, which is inhibitor of alcohol dehydrogenase that used in methanol and ethylene glycol poisoning. And the second one is Disulfiram, which is inhibitor of acetaldehyde dehydrogenase that is used in treatment of alcoholism. So the concept here is that after intake of Disulfiram, even low intake of alcohol will cause massive accumulation of acetaldehyde that will eventually cause severe hangover symptoms that potentially will discourage drinking unless the patient is masochist.